Rescue Mission. I just want to thank everyone for coming today. This is our fifth annual Homeless Persons Memorial Vigil. The National Council on Homelessness celebrates this day every year on December 21st to recognize all those folks that passed away through the year of homelessness. So today we have our vigil, and I'd like to thank everyone who came, all the different agencies, our purchasing department. The whole entire purchasing department, I believe, is here this year. And I just want to give many thanks. And this is a day, I always reflect on this day and think about all the residents of the shelter and all the homeless individuals that walk the boardwalk in the county of Atlantic County and the streets of Atlantic County. And that this is the one day that they get together and be able to recognize and honor and share in the memory of folks that they've lost throughout the year. So with that, I'd like to start and turn the MC over to Ann Thorson.
I want to share something that happened this past year, or actually remember an individual from this past year. Because as I was sitting around thinking about what to say today, one person in particular kept coming in my mind, and that person's name is Don. And Don was someone that I had met very early in my time at JFS. Kelly, your husband actually referred him to me. That's how far back it goes. Don was in his 60s when I first met him. He'd been homeless for a little bit of time. He came to this area after many years living up in North Jersey. And it took some convincing in getting him to accept some assistance. And it wasn't that he was difficult. It was the opposite. I mean, he was always kind of happy and cheerful and happy to see me. But he didn't really want anything. And it wasn't that he was upset with what life was or he had given up. He didn't really want to accept any help. But eventually he did, and I got to learn some more about him. I learned that he was actually born with cerebral palsy and epilepsy. I learned that he worked 35 years at one job and 5 years at the next. He'd been married 40 years, divorced before he came down to Atlantic City, had 3 children that were grown, and seemed by all accounts very successful in their careers and who he was very proud of. He liked the Phillies, Dunkin' Donuts, his tobacco pipe, and also had dreams of living in Ocean City one day. While he was eligible for retirement benefits, when I met him, he didn't want to take them because he always had hope that he would return to work, and he didn't want anything reduced because of that. And one day, you know, that's a little background on Don, but one day out of the blue, he looked at me and he said, you know, Ann, I consider you a friend. I consider you a good friend. And, you know, I don't recall what I said in response, but I'll never forget him saying that. And, you know, through the years, our formal case management relationship ended, but I saw him with some regularity. And sometimes he seemed to be doing really well, and other times not so well. But through it all, his outlook really remained, you know, positive and hopeful. And he seemed to take everything in stride, and he never wanted to be a burden. And he said that to me more than once. Unfortunately, earlier in this year, I was asked to identify a photo, and it was of Don, and he had died, and he had collapsed on the street. And I did have some next of kin information to give the police, and sometime later I did get some very nice letters from his children thanking me for the care and respect that I had given their father and for helping him. And as I responded to those letters, I really became aware of what I had learned from Don, and that was that he never gave up. He accepted his life, if he was doing well or not. He continued to enjoy the simple things in life, his pipe, a good cup of coffee, a ball game, and he valued relationships. And he continued to have dreams and hopes no matter what he was doing. If he was doing well, if he was doing not so well through his physical issues throughout the years. And he gave me a very important point of reference for individuals that constantly want to talk about, you know, homelessness as a problem without ever really asking the question, problems that people experiencing homelessness have. So while I doubt I'll never forget Don, I'll never forget his friendship or the gifts that I have received. And as we move forward with our program today, I would encourage everyone not to just remember the names or the circumstances that may have brought these individuals into our lives, nor the sadness of their deaths. But let us remember those strengths and those gifts that we receive from them by their allowing us to be part of their lives. Because I think that's real important. I mean, it's wonderful that we get together and that we get to remember people that maybe didn't have any other remembrance. But I think it goes deeper than that. You know, that these aren't just names. These aren't just people that died homeless. These are people that gave to us. And in some cases, more so than we, you know, we may have given them. I'm going to turn it over to the first speaker of the day, Mr. Don Parker.
Thank you. I had the opportunity 3 years ago to honor a very good friend of mine, Bob MacArthur, who had been the best man at my wedding. And Bob ended up spending a significant amount of his life here and had a tale that was very similar to the tale Ann just told us, of strength, of conviction. He had been an investigator in a prosecutor's office, done miraculous things in his life. You'll see some of his artwork upstairs. Bill has one of his paintings up in the hallways, Bob MacArthur. As I was driving to work today, I took a different route. I'm driving down Route 40, and I see the mission billboard. And it says, homelessness can happen to anyone. Hope starts here. And what I want to add to it, I'm not going to steal Bill's sermon because he's much better at this, but I'm going to give you a health sermon for a second. And I want you to think about it. I reach into my wallet all the time, and when I reach into it, there's a picture of my kids, and I've got several of them in here, and my kids are what really keep me going all the time. You want to invest in them, you want to do the best for them, and then you lose sight of your obligation to take care of yourself in order to do that. And so every one of you, if I asked you to reach somewhere, you'd find one of those precious moments, what you want to share more of, what you want to do more of, what you want to be a part of. And what I want to ask you to do this year is, especially since it's right here in the mission, is to take advantage of Mission Healthcare. Go there. Get checked out. When you're feeling a little pain or unusual or something's going on, find a way to get there. We've got a lineup of fabulous caregivers. We have over 25 people that work at Mission Healthcare. And they're all about getting you what you need for health, and to get you sober, to get you straight, to get you medications, to do the things that are necessary for you to be able to share your life with the person that's in your wallet or in your suitcase, person that you want to spend more time, the person you want to see grow up, person that you want to see accomplish things that you want to be part of. And we've got it here. We have an unusual opportunity here at Mission Healthcare. Also like to tell you that we're going to take it up a notch. We're in a partnership with the Rescue Mission. We're going to build a medical respite location here at the mission. We were able to get funding for that from the federal government. And we're going to build a place where if you have a medical issue, you can come and stay. We'll provide you with medical attention, make sure that you get an opportunity to recover and recover in the right way. So there's no reason to have a health issue that we don't have an opportunity, or don't give you an opportunity to get care for here. And that includes all throughout Atlanticare, by the way. We provide the third amount of charity, largest amount of charity care in the entire state here at Atlanticare. So that's what we're all about. That's what our mission is about. That's why you see our entire purchasing department here. Wouldn't expect them to be here, but they've been all about helping us be better about what we do and helping out the residents here. On behalf of Atlanticare, take the time. I had a physical this year. I found out I had a heart issue when I was at that physical. I didn't know I had it, and I was able to take care of it. I'm sure it's going to help me spend a lot more time with my family as they mature and I mature. So it's a healthier, happy new year. So this is all about the mission. Homelessness can happen to anybody. Health and hope start here at the Rescue Mission. Ann, thank you very much. Actually, we have a very honored guest. He's sitting anonymously in the crowd now, as he always does. I know I see him in a lot of crowds that he shows up. Jim Whalen, who's our senator. And Jim is a big supporter of the mission of Atlanticare, of all the kinds of programs that we bring to the constituents of this area. Jim, you want to say anything? He is very humble about this. He's personally responsible for helping us get mission health care here and also allowing us to get charity care to pay for a lot of the care that we deliver here. So, Jim, on behalf of all of us who work in this business and all the clients here, thank you for your personal
Next up, we're going to hear from Bill Southree, who I'm sure many of you know, and who has done a great deal in this county for a number of years.
Swing here at the statements I want to make, but first I want to say Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
And I hope that we have a blessed and warm one, and all those of you that stay inside will keep it toasty, I promise. And for those of you who can't get inside, try to get them inside so we can get them warm. That'll make Christmas a little more bearable. I want to say it's been 30-some years that I've been at the mission now, and I think it's a long time. I was teasing Laura, it's time to pass the baton because we haven't ended this crisis yet. I look at your lives and I look at you and I see you sitting here, any of you who are using our facilities, and I say, how can we help you more? How can we do more for you? I don't know. The need's growing. 30 years ago, 50 people was a night that was just so many, we were overwhelmed. 50 people the night I would love to have. That means we would be conquering the problem. I do want to say that since you're here, Senator, thank you for your assistance.
Can you pass to the front desk?
But I also want to say we need more. We do need more. We need city assistance. We need county assistance. We need federal assistance. We need state assistance. We need more to help you. And I'm not talking about giveaways. I'm talking about hard programs that will really help you get into housing and to live your lives more fully and more completely. There's just not enough. Do you think there's enough, Don? No, there's just not enough. For me, every day is a fight to keep the doors open here. You were asking about funding, Senator. We're holding our own, but it's tough when you raise 70% of your income through donations. And I want to tell you, it's arduous work. I'm going to let you know something that I don't tell everybody, but it's time to get it out of the box. I'm a beggar. I am. I'm a beggar. I have nothing against panhandling ever because it's a hard job. I do it on a major scale. But guess where I learned the skills from? You guys. You know, that used to be Case Quarter. Now everybody wants $5. But I ask for hundreds of thousands just so that I can have a place to help you. And we just need more help. So I want to tell you, it's needed, and I'm going to appeal to you, and as the mayor's rep and everybody else that's here, the problem's getting worse. And if you have your health and live outdoors, guess what? You don't have your health for very long. How many people we had on the wall, Lou, that died?
35
that you left, that you lived with in the street.
That I lived with, yes, I buried them.
You know, that's a lot of people. You know, that lived outdoors and died outdoors. Shouldn't be in this country. Shouldn't be in this great city of Atlantic City or the great state of New Jersey. So I'm just going to use the time to appeal and to beg a little more and say let's get serious about helping people. And I want to also apologize to you folks that are staying here for the deficiencies in our services. We're going to try to make them better and better each and every year. We used to have three hots and a cot. Now we're past soup, soap, and hope, and we're actually soup, soap, health, and hope. You know, but we need more. We just need more services, more opportunity, more housing dollars. And I'm going to try to get them for you. I'll be begging harder on your behalf. I'd ask you just to pray for us as we work in our efforts. Don, Laura, what's your name, Ann? And bear with us as we try to help you in your situation. May God grant us peace to each of you. Have a blessed Christmas. And I just want to tell you, we love you.
If we could start lighting, we're going to light the candles, and then we're going to have a couple members of the Consumer Advisory Board, Roy and Johnny, coming up to read the names.
John B. Yanni H. Paul C. Richard E.
Richard S., Roger M., David C., Richard G., John D., Howard F., Michael J., James S., Bernard P., Don A., Antonio A.
Jose R., Robert L., Joshua S., Don M., Desra W., Art G., Marvin T., Joyce T., Ed S., Lorraine P., Estelle M., Richard H., Richard S., and Robert B.